Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another episode of Techne Bites. So tonight we have a very special guest, the icon of hope. He was named as the information technology champion by the Institute of Software Practitioners of Nigeria. Please welcome with me the president of the Africa Business Angel Network, Mr. Harry Tomi Davies. Tomi, how are you?
Tarek, I'm fine, thank you. How's it going?
Very well, very good to see you. I can see you have a very cool background.
Yes, I thought we might as well represent. That was the closest I could get to the Techne one.
Are you calling in from London?
No, actually, I'm in Lagos, Nigeria.
Great, great. And how are things at your end?
They're very, very interesting. Everybody's on tenterhooks here. I'm working with the Nigerian government, trying to help them come up with what we're going to do with the technology ecosystem in Nigeria in response to COVID-19. So I'm chairing a committee for the Nigerian Information Technology Development Agency that's asked us to look into that.
That's great. That's great. I hope you're staying safe, but I understand that Africa is the place to be until now. So things should be much better, safer than any place on the planet.
I'm here for a particular reason in the fact that, you know, I'm here looking on my 87-year-old mother is here. So that's my priority right now.
God bless and stay safe, you and the family. So, Tomi, so you've been advising technology companies for more than 20 years now, and you've wore, you know, several hats all the way throughout the journey. So you've seen a lot of companies, and could you tell us more about most of the mistakes that tech companies that you've seen tend to fall into or that you've ran across?
Ooh, the mistakes. What we tend to see a lot of entrepreneurs, especially the more technical, technology-driven entrepreneurs, tend to be overly optimistic about the solution sets they have and don't engage with customers early enough to understand and to prove their models. If there was going to be one singular thing I had to pick out, it is that, you know, build it and they'll come mentality that we tend to have with tech. We get enamored and, you know, we love it to bits and that's it. We keep driving, not accommodating the customer response.
Okay, so it's focusing on the product without before the customer. And that's
correct.
Where most of the mistakes.
Correct.
Great. So another thing I'd like to ask you, so you've been the CEO of Ernst & Young Business Incubator. It was called Future Wealth. That was like early in the 90s. And that was too early for the, you know, being responsible for an incubator in the 90s and incubators today. Looking at those two different eras, what are the main differentiators that you see and what was the role of the incubator back then?
Well, the Ernst & Young Incubator had a specific strategy at that point in time. And what we were focused on was a strategy we called clicks and mortar, because we believed that the corporates who had been around for a long time but didn't understand the internet and didn't understand the digital world that was coming were best partnering and pairing with those who did. So the purpose of our, and it's still valid till today, and I'll come back to that, because I'm actually an advisor to a company that's doing exactly that on the continent. But the focus at that time was to bring, it's easier to even tell, give a solid example of what was happening. You had P&O Nedloyd, a containerized, you know, they were doing containers all over the world at that time, but their inventory management was physical. It was totally dependent on what happens when the ship arrives. It's docked in London, okay. It's docked in Liverpool. it's docked in New York. How many containers, 20, 40 foot, 20 foot, and all that, they were manual. And we had a startup that came along and says, you know what? We've got these tiny little things that we can put on these containers, and they'll always know where all their containers are. Today, it's pretty much standard. Every single container on a ship has its own GPS tag. But that was the innovation at that point in time. So it was bringing those two together, wasn't it? Was sort of the kind of innovation that the E&Y Future Wealth Incubator was focused on. Today, we have an organization called Hyber. And Hyber essentially does something similar. And what Hyber does is it identifies startups that are potential acquisitions for corporates in the five-year horizon, and then works with the startups towards that goal, while also working with the corporates towards that goal. And sort of by year two, year three, you're starting to see an exchange of resources, including human capital. And that way, the integration becomes quite successful when it happens.
And in today's incubators, are the corporates involved in terms of just mentorship, or are they investing also with the incubator? How are the corporates involved?
Well, it depends on which corporate. Some of them are, in my view, they see ahead. So if you look at what Barclays, for example, did in South Africa, Barclays actually ran the incubator in South Africa, looking at the future of money and the future of payments and things of that nature. So that's sort of the far right extreme. On the other extreme is you'll have corporates that just sponsor competitions. And sitting in between are those that provide both of those, where you'll find some of their senior executives are actually mentoring through the innovation hubs. They're mentoring startups.
And that's something very important in drive, looking at, you know, where the exit will be. And we're, you know, that's where the money comes from. So startups, corporates, and all the people who are working towards nurturing the startup ecosystem need to have some sort of vision on where the exit will be.
Well, I think how do I put this? You've said that with a particular underlying assumption, which let me explain what I mean. 50% of startups fail. Of the remaining 50%, 20% get directly acquired, and another 15% are what we call acqui-hires, which is where the corporate will buy the startup so that it can have the talent base or the talent resource or the intellectual property that that startup owns. So that's 35%. Especially on the African continent. People talk about IPO, 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 but guess what? Less than 0.1% of startups make it to IPO. 0.1%, not 1%, 0.1% make it to IPO. That's why, right from the beginning, understanding where the acquisition is going to occur and how it will occur is critical to think about. And if you're getting mentored by potential acquisitors, then of course that makes a lot of sense.
Absolutely. So back in 2011, you published a book titled Corporate Bold, What Every Corporate Professional Should Know. So can you tell us more about that book, and how is it related to startups and mentorship and all the corporate startup relationship we're talking about?
Well, what had happened was I came out of the graduate school of University of Miami, where I'd done systems analysis. And there was a whole bunch of us from all over the world. I'm talking of Colombia, Kenya, Nigeria was myself and another person, but there were about 20 of us. And each of us was working in a specific area that we believed corporate innovation was necessary. And that's how we came together to put this book together. And if you look at it, you'll find my chapter is actually talking on talent acquisition and how you grow talent and why the traditional mechanisms, okay, of performance measurement were becoming increasingly irrelevant, and outcome-driven objectives and key result areas were they've now become pretty much standard, but at that point in time, that's where we were sort of trying to push people towards, is to get them to move in that direction. So the purpose of corporate bold was actually to set the ground and set the direction, both looking at everything from vendor management, operations management, looking internally at talent acquisition and retention, looking at customer relationship management, looking at all aspects of corporate governance, all the way from board, either directorship or advisory, through to management. And that's sort of what corporate bold was all about.
That's great. And looking now at, you know, the failure rates of the startups and how the corporates operate, I see a lot of complementary areas where both can work together. And you were talking just about exits and the mentors that are working with startups. So looking at the resources that corporates have, they have the market insights and they have the financial resources, but startups don't have these two things, but they have the agility and possibly the innovation that can help them to solve or come up with new solutions that the market actually needs. How do you see that corporate startup relationship working throughout that journey of talent and all the ventures that you've been through?
Well, I think it's like everything, a two-sided coin. I remain to be totally convinced corporates have the monopoly on it, on an industry segment or industry insights. I believe startups bring a lot to that party too. And the agility of startups, like you pointed out, is exactly what corporates need, because they've grown up to become lethargic. And it's what we actually talk to startups about is the fact that as they grow, first of all, you have to standardize your processes. You have to have your roles and responsibilities clearly defined. In short, you got to grow up to become a corporate. So the earlier on you start understanding and you start interacting with corporates, the better off you're going to be. On the other hand, if you look at corporates, the R&D budget has essentially gone south. I don't know of any corporate, not even IBM, who used to lead the charge on R&D, okay, are doing as much R&D as they used to. So increasingly what you are finding is startups are disrupting because of that. Because the corporate's focus is optimizing their revenue. Maximize if you must, as long as your cost base, okay, stays flat while the revenue is increasing. But if they're dragging each other along, then you got to look at it. And that's the corporate world. Startups, on the other hand, are looking at how do I get the hockey curve? Because that's what, you know, startups are all about. And it's sort of bringing those two together over time is really where the relationship does lie. And we're seeing it. We're actually seeing it all the time. If you look at Sook, for example, got acquired by Amazon, okay? I mean, that was what? Over $500 million? And same thing happened. The biggest one, in fact, forget Sook for a minute, Careem. $3.8 billion acquisition by Uber. Now, that's what we're talking about. Those things don't happen overnight. They happen over a period of time where, just like all relationships, both parties get to know each other, both sides to understand the strengths and weaknesses of each of the teams, and that's what brings them together.
Great. Thanks a lot, Tomi. So I see a question open that's related to part of what we were talking about, and instead of waiting until the end, guys, if you have a question, please just, you know, put it in the Q&A section and on the chat. If you just want to say your names and where you're logging from until we get Malden's question. Malden is asking, what are the biggest advantages of startup incubators? He wants to hear your opinion and advice for young startup founders. Big respect and big wishes.
I'll put it quite simply. Just the same thing incubators do in hospitals for babies. That's what incubators do for startups. Not all startups need incubators, But if you're a single individual with a great idea, you don't have a co-founder, you probably want to look up an incubator, because you will find increasingly most of us only invest in teams. That's the start point. The second reason for an incubator is actually helping you with the structures. I tell my people, it's just, you know, look, all startups have two components. There's the proposition, and then there's the organization that delivers it. That's it. So if you consider that as the two fundamentals, then the way we measure them is we measure it economically, which is money, and then we measure them through their milestones, which is time. And these are the measurements that will help. So when you understand that, what an incubator can do for you is to be sure that you are hitting your milestones over time economically. The first milestone, everybody knows, is the minimum viable product. What is that one, you know, how can you put it together without spending a king's ransom to get a product out there that customers will actually pay for, but more importantly, will give you feedback on as to what you could do better with it, and then you start to iterate.
Brilliant. So Tomi, moving from incubators, accelerators, and going into angel investing in 2012, you started the Lagos Business Angel Network. And you started angel investing, I assume, individually and then with the group, or maybe at the same time. But tell us more about that, and how did that start? Who were the members? What kind of deal flow did you have? And you know, as opposed to today, how did that grow?
Well, how do they put it? When things sort of mistakes happen to take you in a particular direction, I didn't know it was called angel investing to start with. A friend had just called up. We'd worked together at M&S in the UK. He'd gone to South Africa. I had gone to Nigeria. He called me up and said, look, we've got this thing we're doing. It's a comic book, and it's going to be really, really great. We're going to do fantasy league football, et cetera. And I said, okay, fine. To cut the long story short was 8 years later, I put in $5,000. Okay, that was the total extent of my big investment at that time as an angel investor. And like I said, I didn't know it was college. But 8 years later, I get a call and saying, we found a buyer who wants to buy 51% of the company, but we're going to need some of your shares to make. 8 years later. I beg your pardon?
No, I'm good. I had a feedback delay.
Okay. I says, okay, fine, you can have it. How much do I get? Are you sitting down? How much did I say I gave him? Can you remember?
$5,000.
Right. Okay. For half my shares, I was given $250,000. And that's when I says, well, hang on, this can't be right. I did, you know, the money sat in my bank account for nearly a month because I thought they'd made a mistake and they were going to ask for the money back. Eventually, when I found out they hadn't made a mistake and the company had really been valued, okay, at that, and there's more to that. I can come to that later because the story doesn't end there. That's how I knew that this was the way to go. So. The funny thing, though, is I then, over the next 2 years, managed to lose just about, well, nearly all of that money investing in startups because I didn't know what I was doing. And that's when I started studying in earnest what a startup is and what they should do, how you should invest. That's when I ran into my current mentors, David Rose of the New York Angel and Candace Johnson, who was the president of the European Business Angel Network. And in learning through that process was, they says, well, you're going to need a network. So Dr. Sulaiman, who's the chairman of the network, and I came together and in 2012 started the Lagos Angel Network. We started with five members. We're currently, I think, in terms of we measure active members, not just members. Active members are those who have invested within the last 12 months. And I think we have 65 full members, but only about 38 or 39 of those are actually active in terms of deal flow. We typically do transactions on average about $50,000 to $60,000. The highest, the biggest deal we've ever done, I think, was Minds.io, and I think that was at about $275,000. And we expect exits to start popping sometime next year.
Brilliant.
And when I say popping, it's because there's been a gradual investment over time.
Yeah. I mean, the whole region is starting to experience some kind of growth towards exits. Now, with what we are experiencing now as a global pandemic, a lot of things have changed, and a lot of things actually are, you know, new to the whole world. So we're trying to see what's happening, and maybe we can get to that also later on. But before I ask you about the Africa Business Angel Network, and this is the one that you are president of, and how did that start, and what does ABAN currently do?
Okay, well, what happened was we had, I think the first one was Minds, the second one was, if I remember, Cafe, there were two startups we had that wanted to expand. So we started looking around because they wanted to go into Kenya, they wanted to go into Ghana. We started looking for who can we reach out to help our startups, you know, move into those spaces, into that direction. At that time, one of my startups, which I don't know, some of you might know it, is called Sproxil. They created what we call pharmacovigilance. So essentially it allows you to actually connect with the drug manufacturers to find out if what you're buying is genuine or fake by sending a free SMS. So it done well in Nigeria, it started in Ghana, and they were looking to expand. They were, funnily enough, Dotun also had one similar, and we just couldn't find anybody. Then we got invited. In fact, we had a conference in Nigeria that we had worked together with, that is our annual early stage investment summit, which we put together with VC for Africa. And then Baybars Altuntash shows up at that time as vice president of the European Business Angel Network, saying, my president has asked that you guys come to Helsinki in November. I says, Helsinki, is that Slush? He says, no. It's happening at the same time as Slush, but it's EBAN. What's EBAN? Oh, EBAN is the European Business Angel Network. We've been discussing that you guys need to do something similar in Africa, etc. So we went. And Rebecca Enonchong, Cameroon Angel Networks, Alexander Frazier, who is now the founder of the Dazzle Angels, the women's only angels in Cape Town. Chris Campbell, who is the South Africa Business Angel Network. At that time, there was the Ghana Angel Investment Network and ourselves, along with the VC for Africa guys. And the conversation was, okay, what are the challenges? The challenges is, first, there aren't any angels in Africa. The sum total of all the angels at that time, we did a search, and I think somebody was trying to do something in Morocco. And I know that Ali El Shakani and the others had just started in Cairo. There was also umming and ahhing in Tunisia around the Carthage Angels, and that was it. There was nothing else on the radar. So the birth of ABAN was driven by the need to do three things, which we still hold there. The first is to identify and educate individuals who could become angel investors, to help them understand angel investing and give them all the tools they need to become angel investors. The second is to then help them create angel networks. And that's where you and I started talking, if you remember, is the fact that, you know, hunting in packs is one of the things I learned the hard way. Remember, I told you I'd made this couple of $100,000 and, you know, a year and a half later, I had less than $15,000 of that left because I didn't know what I was doing. If I'd been part of a network, that would never happen. And the third and final is unique to Africa, because we believe that unlike other continents where angel investing is a financial asset, that angel investing in Africa should be seen as a development asset, because Africa is not as mature an environment as Europe and the others. So we're engaging with policymakers all the way from the AU through to national governments to help them move angel investment in that direction, because then angel investors will start to get benefits similar to what is obtaining in places like Turkey and the United Kingdom and the United States in terms for their efforts.
Brilliant. So Tomi, this is amazing. That's a great journey. And we have a question here. We'll just jump into that from Paul, who's originally from Ghana. Hi, Paul. Thanks for joining. So Paul's asking, how does a startup describe its exit to investors at seed and Series A stage?
Okay. First thing is you need to understand that the exit is not about you. The exit is about the investor. So this is about, if I give you money, how do I get it back? That's what the question is really, really about. That's what exit strategies, which is what we ask startups for. That is what it's all about. So there are, as we were talking about earlier, quite a number of different exit approaches that we are finding, you know, applicable. It's mostly sale, okay? 5 years from now, I expect to be acquired by this large corporate. That is what pervasively obtains on the continent. Like I've said, IPOs are not really. But I have a startup that pleasantly surprised us. And they declared a dividend because they were cash positive to the point where they felt, yes, we can do without 20% of the cash we're holding and we're going to give it to our shareholders. Now, that sounds, yes, yeah, so what's the big deal on that? Typically, you would expect that to be a percentage of your investment. So I put in $10,000, okay, maybe I'll get $1,000 in dividends. What you're not expecting is to get $5,000 when you've invested $10,000, which is exactly what has happened to us. So again, dividends, if you are seeing yourself as, you know, being able to generate that level of cash, is increasingly becoming, especially given some of the cultures on the continent where we're anti-sale. So I built this, I'm not selling it. You know, it's a lifestyle for me, and then I'll buy you out if the need be. So again, you just need to think it through as to where you want to end up as the owner of this company that you are creating. And that's all, you know, it's an honest conversation with your investors. If you can't be open and honest with them, then they're probably the wrong investors to have anyway.
Brilliant. Thanks, Tomi. And so yeah, jumping back to you, as Tomi, as an individual angel investor, do you have any sectors that you are most interested in? And how has that changed during, you know, what we're in now and during the pandemic? Will that change what sectors you're interested in?
Let me answer the first question, because I have to think about, you know, the impact of the pandemic on my portfolio. We're actually in the middle of trying to do some things there. But I do technology-enabled startups, simply because that's my background. I started out life as a software engineer in IBM, and all throughout my life, that's pretty much, you know, what I've done is technology. So I focus on technology-enabled plays. But in terms of industry, I'm quite passionate, as anybody knows me knows, I'm passionate about education, simply because I believe technology-enabled learning is the future. And we're just not moving in that direction fast enough. I have invested in media. I've put money in logistics. I'm just trying to think through the portfolio now. I've put money, yes, in food and beverages, agri-tech, and my latest investment is in energy, renewables. Now, in terms of impact and what COVID-19 will do, well, the first thing is we know there's been a paradigm shift in terms of social. So there's going to be a significant social impact. I expect every sector that aggregates human beings will be fundamentally changed by this. What do I mean by that? So if you look at restaurants, buses, ships, airplanes, cinema houses, religious houses, all of these are set for disruption by this pandemic. How that will manifest, I think, is going to be left to be some of the people listening to this to make happen.
Great. That's great. These are great insights. And back to your point about education, which you have a lot of passion for, and you mentioned we're not moving fast enough. Do you think that in light of the current conditions, a lot of people are starting to connect with schools, with students, postgraduate universities, with also their students? Do you think that this will push tech enabling education or better education? How will that impact from, you know, how do you see that and what's the impact?
Well, Get Smarter, a South African startup, I think went for about 100 million 2 years ago. China moved 50 million students online in one fell swoop. What do those two have to do with each other? Well, it's very simple. You talked about connectivity. It's a bit more than that, because education is cultural infusion. Okay? The reason Egyptians speak the local language is because they're educated that way. The reason Chinese speak Mandarin is the same, and so on and so forth. So what we're going to start to see, in my opinion, okay, is some kind of regionalized effort on education, simply because people are starting to understand that, hang on, yeah, it's this globalization thing is nice, but the global value chain is actually a myth. It's more of a regional value chain if we're going to say sustainable, especially as we start to look at how are we going to make sure that Earth doesn't get destroyed by us. The icebergs are melting. You know, we're starting to see rain where it's never rained before. We're seeing snow in weird places. Look at the Australian forest fires. It goes on and on and on. All of these are contributing to the rethink about the meaning of education. We're moving out of the historical learning by rote traditional mechanisms, which is more about memory and memory management and acquisition of knowledge into memory, more into the applied learning and the ability to learn on demand. So it becomes continuous lifelong learning. And your talent, your innate talent as a human being, then becomes what you apply through what you've learned. And that to me is where I think we're starting to head. And whether it's being led by China or it's going to be led by others, that's a big, big question mark. I don't think anybody can answer, but definitely it's game on.
Absolutely. So Tomi, we also have a question from an anonymous attendee asking, an incubator versus an accelerator.
They're two different things.
Yeah. What are the differences?
Well, an incubator brings an idea to life. Their role is to get you to that MVP, is to get you to that first customer, is to make sure you're thinking right about the market you're attacking, the functions, the features, and the products, okay, that you are putting out there, to make sure that, yes, everything is in place for you to start the business. That's like giving birth. An accelerator, on the other hand, is really to get you to the next level. There are five stages of, you know, of a startup. Stage one is actually incubation, which is what you've talked about now, and that is starts at MVP. Stage two is where you're looking for what we call product market fit. So you're testing, you're continuously testing it. By the time you get to stage three, you're in growth. And that's where you typically need an accelerator. Because growth management, which is what startups are about, in highly uncertain circumstances, really needs help. The marketing approach and marketing strategy is fundamentally different. Your talent acquisition strategies are going to be different. Okay. And guess what? By the time you get to that, if you're a startup, you've also got investor management that you've got to consider. These are all things your accelerator must help you do to get you to where you need to be. I hope that helps.
That's great. That helps a lot, Tomi. Thank you. And we have another question that says, since the capital markets in Africa are not liquid, which exits do African angel investors consider? That's for Kwame. I'm sorry.
Well, Kwame, like I said earlier, it's always acquisition, acquisition, acquisition. 80%, 80% of all angel exits are through acquisitions. VCs won't let us exit. We used to, you know, I remember about 5 years ago getting on stage and saying, oh yeah, angel investors exit to VCs. But my personal experience, they come in and they will not let you touch their money. They want that money to go to growth so they can get the startup to the next stage. And where we've had exits, remember I was talking about half of my shares gave me $250,000? Well, the remaining half got sold to Moonbug. Okay, so Moonbug bought the Strike Entertainment Company. And are you ready for this? That was last year. This year, they sold it to Disney. What we couldn't do.
Okay, we do what we do best. They do.
Yeah, exactly. So Kwame, the answer is acquisition, acquisition, acquisition. Who in your industry is the regional champion or the continental or global champion that you could be a potential acquisition target for? That's why I use the example of Kareem going to Uber as sort of what we're talking about here. I hope that helps.
That relates very much, and specifically Kareem and Uber. And I think after that exit, the shareholders and the early employees and the founders themselves are actually very good examples of how great angel investors will be in the future. And they'll start founders, of course, serial entrepreneurs. So either they'll start something, which some of them already have, or start investing in several other ventures, which is an amazing thing that we'll start seeing. So there's a personal question to you from Khadur. She's asking, do you invest in healthcare?
Do I invest in healthcare? It's funny. What, have you been looking on my DD? I'm actually in the process of doing due diligence on a health product, only because I missed out on a startup that's really, really done well now. And I felt, they came to me first. It was medical devices as a service. And I'm saying, what's that? You must be joking. It's not possible. Da, da, da. But guess what? They've gone on, they've raised funding, they've done extremely well, and they're doing so well now. This is not in that space, but definitely the answer is yes. There are a lot of opportunities on both sides of the north, south, east, and west of the continent in healthcare.
Great. And Ahmed is asking, in light of these disasters from pandemic and expected stagnation, do you expect that there will be integration between emerging projects in developing economies in African countries, or will the founders work to be isolated islands as they are?
Not if I have anything to do with it. Collaboration, collaboration, collaboration. That's why I'm on this call, and we've been working together. The last time we saw was in collaboration in Turkey, okay? Yeah. And I honestly believe that, you know, yes, you do need individual excellence and you need focus, but there's an African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go with friends. That's what I believe should be happening, is going with friends, because we want to go sustainably far.
Absolutely. Thanks, Tomi, for the great words of wisdom. And we have Jordan here asking, how relevant is Silicon Valley post-COVID to the rest of the world?
It will depend on the Chinese. Much as the Americans don't like to hear that, if you look at where Silicon Valley funding's come from for the last 5 to 10 years, you'll understand why I'm answering that way. The relationship between the US and China will define the relevance of Silicon Valley to the rest of the world post-COVID.
Great. So we'd like to take all the questions, but we have a lot. So the last question would be to you, Tomi, from your point of view as general advice to different startups who are in different stages raising funds right now during the pandemic. You always say that startups need to pitch for mentors and not just cash. So this is like the cherry on the top. But what are your words of advice to all the startups listening to us now raising funds?
If you are a startup raising funds, I'll take you through a sequence. The first is, have your people invested in you? Your family, your friends, have they given you money? And what have you done with that? That's the first question. Let's assume, yes, I got X from my mom or my dad or my uncle or my, you know, whoever, my friends, and this is what we've done. You can tell that story. That's sort of the first thing. The next and probably the most important is your network. You must learn how to network, because what is increasingly happening, what we're finding is, who's gonna send the pitch deck? And I find myself doing exactly the same thing. If I get a pitch deck from Tarek, I'm more likely to look at it than if it comes unsolicited from the startup itself. So that's what I mean by your network. If you can avoid raising funds at this time, then avoid it and try and get through. But if you do have to raise, you're going to need to network, okay, to the funder, because everybody, planet-wise, right now, it's all trust-based systems kicking in.
Yeah. Tomi, I'd like to thank you so much. These were 45 minutes from your time. Very valuable. I'm always happy to see you. And I hope get better soon, so that we can meet physically again, hopefully at the Techne Summit end of September in Alexandria. Otherwise, anywhere else, it's always good to see you. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
And definitely connect soon. So have a great evening and stay safe.
Thank you. You take care.
Thanks. So guys, this was Tomi Davies, president of the Africa Business Angel Network. Don't miss our next episode on Tuesday, where we have Peter Cowley. He's the president of the European Business Angel Network. And we'd like to thank all our partners, all our outreach partners. Thanks for joining us. And please send our questions through to our email. Thank you. Have a good evening. Yeah.